हरे कृष्ण डियर डिवोटीज, हरे कृष्ण माता जी, प्लीज एक्सेप्ट माई हम्बल ओबेसेंसेस। ऑल ग्लोरीज टू श्रील प्रभुपाद, ऑल ग्लोरीज टू गुरु महाराज। सो टुडे वी हैव ग्रेट प्लेजर टू हैव हर ग्रेस ललितांगी राधा माता जी अमंग अस। जस्ट ए ब्रीफ बैकग्राउंड अबाउट माता जी, शी इज एन इनिशिएटेड डिसाइपल ऑफ हिज होलीनेस जयप्रताका स्वामी महाराज। एंड During her high school, she attended a Bhagavad Gita contest and won a prize to go to Mayapur and got inspired and took up chanting 16 rounds and later got initiated from Maharaj in Mayapur. She is engineer and worked as a lecturer also in various colleges. And during her college days, she was actively serving ISKCON Coimbatore under the guidance of His Holiness Bhakti Vinod Maharaj in outreach program. Temple festivals, college programs, and cultural programs. And after her marriage in 2003, she had served many temples and congregations, initially at ISKCON Silicon Valley and later at ISKCON Santiago, Chile, where she was conducting Bhakti Briksha in Spanish, and then in Manchester, UK, and India from 2013. She has been living and serving in Charlotte, where she was active in conducting Bhakti Briksha. Kids class, book distribution, coordinating outreach programs, so many activities. Right now, Mataji lives in Toronto, Canada, and serving new Ramuna Dham. So, today's topic is Srila Prabhupada, an example of determination. Over to you, Mataji. Thank you.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, my humble obeisances to all the assembled devotees. Actually, I don't deserve all this, just that. Because of Srila Prabhupada's effort, he built a house in which the whole world can live. So wherever our job and our karma took us in various different places, I was blessed with the association of devotees. And I can surely say that because of that, I'm still alive, chanting and trying to serve a little bit. So all glory to Srila Prabhupada and our spiritual masters who are following in his footsteps. So let me offer prayers. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurum Nilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prashtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine. Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Chacharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Veshatarine Vancha Kalpata Rubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Eva Cha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Sri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langayate Gurum, Yat Kripatamaham Vande Sri Gurum Dinakarinam, Paramananda Madhavam Sri Chaitanya Nishwaram. Thank you so much for giving this opportunity to share a few reflections. This is Kartik month, and everywhere devotees are absorbed and immersed in glorifying the Lord, his pastimes, Vrindavan Dham, and also glorifying the pastimes of Radha and Krishna, especially in this month. And whenever we enter into a ISKCON temple, we see the aroma of the incense and flowers and the opulent deities of Radha and Krishna, Jagannath Balabhadra Subhadra and Gauri Thai, welcoming us with beams of smiles, as are saying that, you know, now you have come, don't go away from me. So we can all recollect what impressions we have when we visited the Dham, and also Srila Prabhupada's created ISKCON temples that's equivalent to Dhams. Especially, I mean, I few times we had the opportunity to visit New Dwaraka Dham, Los Angeles, and seeing the devotees there taking part in Mangal Aarti and before the deities, and that's been going on for years and years and years. So many, at least 50 years now. That whole place looks like the vibration, the ether there. Devotees, hundreds and thousands of rounds of Mahamantra has been chanted, glorified and worshipped. And that place is definitely, when a person enters, get cut off from the Kali Yuga surroundings of the Los Angeles outside. And it's quite a distinct feeling of entering into a different realm whenever we enter into ISKCON temple. And we are very, very grateful to Srila Prabhupada, without whose efforts these things would not have manifested. And not small efforts, but a persistent Herculean, Himalayan efforts, overcoming all obstacles. Of course, Srila Prabhupada would have been a history if not his disciples and our spiritual masters who are carrying on with dedication his mission and giving it to us now, that what they have gone through in the early ages is also, you know, books can be written on that, especially New Vrindavan. We can see that it is very, very, it was very, very cold, taking ice showers basically. And when Guru Maharaj came to my home, he saw the picture of new Radha Vrindavan Nath. And then he said that for, I don't remember exactly, 7 or 8 years, that in the Brahmachari Ashram, how he had been worshipping the deities and how he had cleaned the altar again and again and again, and how he was cooking and all those. I mean, those amazing sacrifices out of, we are very, very, no words to explain to that. We are very, very grateful. And I hope I hope and I request blessings from our spiritual masters to carry on this legacy, because somehow or other we have been accepted into the parampara, and seeing their glorious qualities of dedication and service, come what may. In tolerating any amounts of physical, any amount of any inconvenience from any side, but determined and grounded in serving the spiritual master, that is something that we can see even now. So I was thinking we can read something from Lilamrita. Before that, maybe we can read from Nectar of Instruction. Can I share the screen?
Yes, Mataji, I made you co-host.
I'm sorry, it's getting a little delayed here. Verse text 3. That's a very wonderful verse, and I've had many, many lectures on this. Many of you must have studied it, written exams on this. This is very something that we can remind us every single day, because bhakti is not a one day process. Every day and every moment, we are thrown in the process, and we have to handle so many challenges. So reminding us of this, and also seeing how Srila Prabhupada led a life. He not only wrote this books, he was an example of this. And you can see that how example speaks louder than words. Just reading the text and some part of the book. Sahan nishchayat dairyat tat tat karma pravartanat संगत्यागात सतो प्रत्ये श्रद्धिर भक्ति प्रसिद्ध्यति. Translation, there are six principles favorable to the execution of pure devotional service. Being enthusiastic, endeavoring with confidence, being patient, acting according to regulative principles such as Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Smaranam, hearing, chanting and remembering Krishna, abandoning the association of non-devotees, and following in the footsteps of the previous acharyas. These six principles undoubtedly assure the complete success of pure devotional service. So I'm just going to read about being patient and endeavoring with confidence. Endeavor executed with intelligence in Krishna consciousness is called utsaha or enthusiasm. The devotees find the correct means by which everything can be utilized in the service of the Lord. Nirbhanda Krishna sambandhe yuktam vairagyam uchyate. The execution of devotional service is not a matter of idle meditation, but practical action in the foreground of spiritual life. So here Srila Prabhupada is explaining what is utsaha, what is enthusiasm. So using our intelligence and doing practical action in the foreground of spiritual life with the spiritual goals and to achieve in the end, but we use our intelligence and do something practical. So that is enthusiasm. Is a very very, very beautiful. How much ever you try, we cannot find something better than what Srila Prabhupada has written. That is, even to absorb and repeat it is so hard. Endeavor executed with intelligence in Krishna consciousness is called utsaha or enthusiasm. These are all like Vedanta sutras. Yeah. So let's read the next one. These activities must be executed with patience. One should not be impatient in Krishna consciousness. Indeed, this Krishna consciousness movement was started single-handedly. And in the beginning, there was no response. But because we continued to execute our devotional activities with patience, people gradually began to understand the importance of this movement. And now they are eagerly participating. One should not be impatient in discharging devotional service, but should take instructions from the spiritual master and execute them with patience, depending on the mercy of Guru and Krishna. The successful execution of Krishna conscious activities requires both patience and confidence. A newly married girl naturally expects offspring from her husband, but she cannot expect to have them immediately after marriage. Of course, as soon as she's married, she can attempt to get a child, but she must surrender to her husband, confident that her child will develop and be born in due time. Similarly, in devotional service, surrender means that one has to become confident. The devotee thinks, Avashya Rakshibe Krishna. Krishna will surely protect me and give me help for the successful execution of devotional service. This is called confidence. So such a beautiful explanation of what is patience and confidence. He says that because there are no results, one should not be expecting results to manifest immediately, even though it's going to take time. One has to be patient. But during being patient, one should not become hopeless. So one has to have both patience and confidence. So while executing the devotional service with patience, one depends on the mercy of Guru and Krishna. And here, especially he says, indeed, this Krishna consciousness movement was started single-handedly. And in the beginning, there was no response. So in this connection, we can read something from Srila Prabhupada Lilamrita. It was not an easy thing what Srila Prabhupada accomplished this, especially so we saw this a kind of a summary of 13 and 14 chapter Butler, Pennsylvania, how he landed and what is Mrs. Sari Agarwal's account of Srila Prabhupada, and then how he moved to New York and he was with Dr. Ramamurthy Mishra, and what all problems he faced there. He was silenced. He couldn't, while he came to, he wanted to go to West. He did not have money. He took the ship and a free ticket and two heart attacks, and then landed in Butler, Pennsylvania. And then with only 1 month more visa, he landed in New York. There are people coming who are interested, young people, but he can talk that God is a supreme personality of Godhead. So he was silenced because the person whom he was depending on was preaching impersonalism. And so how inconvenient it was, one after another after another. So then Dr. Mishra moved him to a house, I mean, to a place, to a small studio apartment. It cannot even be called an apartment because there are no windows there and there is no kitchen equipment there. So he had to walk 10 blocks to even start cooking, to cook, and he would cook for Dr. Ramamurthy Mishra also. So how cold it was. It was, we can see that, you know, the weather was freezing. The weather went below freezing and colder than he had ever experienced in India. What was his age? 17 years. And he had, if anyone had visited 26 Second Avenue, we can see that how it is still so windy when you come towards the Hudson Bay. And even in the early winter, it is so windy there and it makes it very cold and chill. See, this is what, and in that he had to walk daily. He had to walk towards the Hudson against the west wind that even on an ordinary winter's day would take your breath away and make your eyes water and your face grow numb. And we have experienced this one. We went for New York Rath Yatra, and after that we went to visit 26 Second Avenue, and then when we walked towards the Hudson Bay, it was really cold. On a stormy day, the driving wind and sudden gusts could even knock a man down. Sometimes a cold rain would turn the streets slick with ice. The cold would become especially severe as one approached the shelterless, wind-swept area of the West Side Drive, where occasional whirlwinds carried brown leaves and paper trash mysteriously high into the air. So that was the whirlwind. And in that, what Srila Prabhupada did, Srila Prabhupada wore a coat Dr. Mishra had given him. But he never gave up wearing his dhoti, despite the cold, windy walks. Swami Nikhilananda of Ramakrishna Mission had advised Prabhupada, if he wanted to stay in the West, he should abandon his traditional Indian dress and strict vegetarianism. Meat eating and liquor, as well as pants and coat, were almost a necessity in this climate, he had said. Before Prabhupada had left India, one of his godbrothers had demonstrated to him how he should eat in the West with a knife and fork. But Prabhupada never considered taking on Western ways. His advisors cautioned him not to remain an alien, but to get into the spirit of American life, even if it meant breaking vows he had held in India. Almost all Indian immigrants compromise their old ways, but Prabhupada's idea was different, and he could not be budged. The others may have had to compromise, he thought, but they had come to beg technological knowledge from the West, I have not come to beg something, he said, but to give something. So we can see that how he was sticking to wearing a dhoti. I have heard in the lecture that when Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur sent his disciples west, some of them, he said that the dress doesn't matter. He was also wearing coat and other things. He had advised or did not stress on wearing Vaishnava attire if that is required to preach and convince them. But Srila Prabhupada, even in the cold winter, he kept up to wearing a dhoti. And if you remember before, when he took the Vanaprastha order and he came away from family, he was in Jhansi, League of Devotees, and he was trying very hard. He almost established, I think, more than 10 months to 1 year, the program was going on. But at that time, the governor's wife wanted that for a ladies' party. It was actually a haunted house, but Srila Prabhupada took it and then made it into a thriving temple. But finally, he had to walk out. He even mentions that I wouldn't have given that up, but I didn't want to put, there was a middle person who was engaged and the collector's wife was giving pressure on him. And he didn't want to put him in trouble, and he took it as Krishna's will, and he left there. And then he went and stayed in Delhi for some time, in Mathura, in one of the godbrothers' mutts, Gaudiya mutt, and then in Delhi for some time. So there, when he is staying there, he was doing many different services there, especially he was writing and also taking care of the newsletters. And then he was also writing letters to the godbrother who was running the mutt, and he was in, I think, Calcutta. So one letter he wrote, and he's saying that I want to bring this magazine, the weekly magazine. I think it was that time also called Back to Godhead, to the level of Illustrated Weekly. And for that, I want to meet influential men to get them to sponsor this, because we have so much content. But I have only two dhotis and both of them are torn. So, you know, if you have to meet a respectable person, you need to be at least not dressed in torn clothes. So he was actually looking after the finances of the mutt. And he was sent there to, the things were not going on that properly. So he was taking care of the finances, and he was taking care of the Back to Godhead magazine. And then he was doing all the other managerial work that's required. And he was writing to his godbrother to request him permission if he can get two nice dhotis, so that he can be in a presentable way when he goes to meet influential men to get sponsorships. So that is Srila Prabhupada. Doesn't take one penny for himself, even though it is required for service. He's asking the permission. I think I will look it up and share it. That was in the previous chapters, volume one. So we can see that how determined he was amidst all odds. Hundreds of people, I mean, in fact, people didn't even think that he could do something substantial here. And even though he came here, many, many, many advised him what to do. But he was fixed up. He wouldn't compromise. And then he met one Ruben. He is a Turkish Jew, and he is working as a New York City subway conductor. At that time, he had practically no one. So this is what Ruben had to say. He seemed to know that he would have temples filled up with devotees. He would look out and say, I am not a poor man. I am rich. There are temples and books. They are existing. They are there. But the time is separating us from them. He always mentioned me and spoke about the one who sent him, his spiritual master. He didn't know people at that time, but he said, I'm never alone. He always looked like a lonely man to me. That's what made me think of him like a holy man, Elijah, who always went out alone. I don't believe he had any followers. So this was Srila Prabhupada, literally on his own. But what he was doing when he was on, we saw in the previous chapter that he found a nice a property, a building to buy, which can be turned into a first Radha Krishna temple in New York. But he had to pay a down payment of $20,000 for that. And so he was writing to everyone. And one of the people who he wrote was Padampat Singhania. So before that, this is something very interesting, that how Prabhupada made money to the coat was of course given by Dr. Ramamurthy Mishra, because seeing him shivering in cold, he must have given him a coat. But he has to cook, he has to buy groceries, and he had no money. So how did he make that money? So this is what. Although Srila Prabhupada did no Christmas shopping, he visited many bookstores. Orientalia, Sam Weiser's, Doubleday, The Paragon and others, trying to sell his Srimad Bhagavatams. This is Ferber, the wife of the Paragon Book Gallery proprietor, considered Prabhupada a pleasant and extremely polite, small, gentleman. The first time he called, she wasn't interested in his books. But he tried again, and she took several volumes. Prabhupada used to stop by about once a week, and since his books were selling regularly, he would collect. Sometimes when he needed copies to sell personally, he would come by and pick them up from Mrs. Ferber, and sometimes he would phone to ask her how his books were selling. Mrs. Ferber, every time he came, he would ask for a glass of water. If a customer would make such a request, how I would ordinarily say, that is a water cooler. But because he was an old man, I couldn't tell him that, of course. He was very polite, always, very modest and a great scholar. So whenever he would ask, I would fetch him a cup of water personally. Once Prabhupada was talking with Mrs. Ferber about Indian cuisine, and she mentioned that she especially liked samosas. The next time he paid her a visit, he brought a tray of samosas, which she enjoyed. And this is Srila Prabhupada's love and care. And I heard a lecture in which one of the disciples of Srila Prabhupada, he was saying, why wouldn't he go and ask her a glass of water every time he came? Because that Prabhu was telling that to distribute his books, she needed to be having some devotional credit. And by asking her to bring him a glass of water, she is engaging in some seva to the Vaishnavas, and especially to him. So because of that service to Srila Prabhupada, she was empowered to distribute, to sell his books. And Srila Prabhupada was aware of that to give her that sukriti, he would ask her a glass of water every time he came. And also we can see that ordinarily she would have replied, she would have told that, there is a water cooler, help yourself. But because the way Srila Prabhupada interacted was so polite, so modest, an old man, a great scholar. He is the author of the books and he's coming himself. And, seeing his humility and gentleness, she was obliged to bring her the cup of the water, which empowered her to distribute his books. And also see how Srila Prabhupada reciprocates in a remembering way to bring her this plate of samosas the next time he came back. So then we saw this Harvey Cohen, who visited the Swami in Ananda Ashram, when he used to go to Ananda Ashram along with Dr. Mishra. And he told to Harvey Cohen that, Bhakti Yoga is much better than the yoga that you are practicing. And so Harvey Cohen used to visit him in this room. And he calls this a tiny office at the back of the yoga society. So he used to go there, and there was nothing there. What was there? I began to go there regularly, and we sat facing each other on the floor in his little office with his typewriter and a new tape recorder on top of two suitcases. You can see that there are not, that's not even a table, there's no rug, no furniture. And there was a box of books he had brought from India and a colored reproduction of dancing figures, which he looked at often. I told Swami Bhaktivedanta that I was an artist. And he asked me to please paint the picture of the dancers, which he explained was of Lord Chaitanya and his disciples. The painting was called Sankirtana. Whenever I came to visit him, Swami would always be happy to see me. I told him about myself and we chanted Hare Krishna together in his room many nights that winter. I would get the train uptown from my apartment to go see him. So there were a few coming, not even a handful, maybe one or two or three coming by and talking to him. And he was ready to encourage them. And we have seen a picture of Srila Prabhupada with Lal Bahadur Shastri admiring Srila Prabhupada's books. Prabhupada had written to him many times. And after coming here, he wanted for the money to come from India. He's thinking about the $20,000 down payment for the Radha Krishna temple to buy the building. And he had already communicated with a few of his godbrothers and possible donors from India. But the point is, how would one bring that much money from India to US at that time? So it required personal sanction, a special sanction, and which he was hoping to get from Prime Minister Lal Bahadur Shastri, because he had personal relationship with him. But what happened, Lal Bahadur Shastri was supposed to come to New York after visiting Russia, but he died of a heart attack while visiting Russia. So what happened with that? His untimely death was a great upset in Srila Prabhupada's plan to purchase a building at 143 West 72nd Street. The realtors had shown him the building and he had already mentally designed the interior for deity worship and distribution of prasadam. The money was to come from India and Prime Minister Shastri was to do personal sanction for release of the funds. So he had planned, he had written to him, he wanted to meet him when he comes to New York and request him this. But suddenly, that was all changed. Now, I mean, how could he get anything now? So he's writing back to the owner of the building. And so he's saying that my plans has changed because the Prime Minister is suddenly dead. But anyway, the house is vacant, lying down for and you have to pay taxes and anything. So let us use the house. And eventually when people started coming and I can get some sympathy locally, then I can get money from India. But right now you can become one of the directors of this public institution, because you will give me this place to start the institution. Rather, he's asking him, please, you know, let us use this. Right now, I have no means to pay for this. But because we are using your institution, you can become one of the directors of this public institution. And I'm hopeful that when people come, I can arrange some money. But who will be interested? I mean, it's all like post-dated checks. So he wasn't interested. But Prabhupada didn't give up. And he had been writing to one Padampat Singhania. And he's a director of a big JK organization in India, very wealthy. And it would be very easy for him to give financial support of a few thousands of dollars. So he has written to him asking him that, you know, we are all devotees of Krishna and we can get together to build a temple for Krishna and I need your help. And he is telling two possible problems. What is that? The same thing. We have got to send foreign exchange for building the temple for which government sanction is required. Without the government sanction, no money can be sent abroad. It was not internet age, right? So there's not even computers. So everything has to be, I mean, takes its own time and approval. So if the government of India agrees, then one can think of erecting a temple in New York. The first thing itself, he is putting a big thing. Why would a government of India agree for this? The second, I doubt whether with the small amount of rupees 7 lakhs, which was at that time $110,000, a temple can be built in New York, because Prabhupada is asking only that much money for him and which he can very well give. But what is his reason is, I mean to carry out a nice construction with Indian type of architecture. To get a temple completed in Indian type of architecture, we have to send a man from India. So these are the two main difficulties. He's a businessman, so he's saying that these are two big hurdles that cannot be crossed. But Prabhupada did not leave that. So he says that, you know, first you send me 7 lakhs, we will purchase the house, then we will build another story upon it, and then we will make the architecture a temple, dome, chakra, anything that we want. But first, you know, let me purchase that with this amount, 7 lakh rupees. And then he also says that in Dwaraka, Krishna is very opulent and there are palaces. But in Vrindavan, he is just, you know, he's just wearing a cloth as a turban and with a flute and with a dhoti, he's going around. And there is no royal opulence. So he says that the mood of Vrindavan like devotion, then combined with Dwaraka like wealth, then we both can, you know, the Lord can be properly worshipped. So he's telling that because he's from Vrindavan, he can think of worshipping the Lord, not maybe in an opulent way, like, you know, a properly built temple with Indian architecture and domes and other things. That may take a long time. And also getting that done at that point of time looks impossible, but rather just buy that whatever is available and start worshipping the Lord and then add on to this. But let's see what he replied for that. Before that, he's asking Bon Maharaj that, you know, please send me a 14-inch brass deities of Radha and Krishna. And Bon Maharaj writes that it's a big responsibility to start deity worship. But Srila Prabhupada says that, you know, he has studied the men here and with proper training. You know, there are so many other societies that they are training the people, like Ananda Yoga Ashram, where he visited. You can see that at that time, like, there was no much Indians like now. Only 1955 immigration laws were relaxed, or 1965, something around that time. And I remember Suresh Prabhu, who's the disciple of Srila Prabhupada, telling that at that time, when he sees a person from a foreign origin, either India or China, it's rare. It's a person, like when he was standing in a queue in his university to buy something, and at that time he found one person from Asia and everyone would turn and look him around. That was how rare people were there at that time. It was not very common. So he's but still yoga ashrams and others were thriving with all local people. So he's giving that example to Bon Maharaj, saying that we can train them up. But first thing is, we wanted a worship, but that is based on Srimad Bhagavatam. So after that, you know, there was a snowstorm and he didn't have even a, you know, he just had one overcoat and a Swami hat, and he was seeing how the dogs were wearing raincoats and makinas, and they were going around for a walk, and then, you know, how he was surprised with all of that. And then came snow and blizzards and emergency, and Srila Prabhupada alone had to pass through all of this. Then again, he wrote to Tirtha Maharaj telling that Padampad Singhania is ready to give the donation, but we have to get the government sanction. So he's pressing on the first point. Let us get the government sanction done so that we can start on this. And he's again and again remembering that it was Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati's mood and desire that we need to have a worldwide organization. So please, can you do this? But meanwhile, Padampad Sanghanya replied that, what is that? I'm afraid that I cannot agree with your suggestion that you should buy a small house and erect something on top of it. Unfortunately, such a kind of proposal will not suit me. The temple must be a small one, but it must be constructed properly. I quite agree that you cannot spend a lot of money at present, but within the amount the government may sanction, you should build something according to the architecture of Indian temples. Then only will we be able to create some impression on the American people. This is all I can write to you in this connection. I'm very grateful for your taking the trouble of writing me. So it's like he got, they say that, you know, he got something in near his mouth, but it didn't enter his mouth. It's like that. He found someone who has money, who can donate, who also has a desire to build a temple, but he has another type of idea that it has to be built a small one according to the architecture of Indian temples. So even though the government sanction, he's putting pressure on to relieve that, but this is a big thing. So almost he says that this is all I can write to you in this connection. That means the topic is closed. But what Srila Prabhupada's determination is, Prabhupada did not take this letter as final. He maintained hope that Sir Padampad Singhania would still give money for the temple if only the transfer of money could be arranged. He continued writing his godbrothers and other devotees, asking them to try to secure the government sanction. He maintained the same aspirations, even though his sole prospective donor had rejected his scheme of a chakra and a dome atop a conventional two-story building. So he's still continuing. I mean, there's only one donor and he also gave him up, but still he continued. Meanwhile, he moved from room 501 downstairs, two floors to a room all his own. Now he had to pay the rent. So he's writing, I have changed my room to room 307 in the same building as above mentioned for better air and light. It is on the roadside junction of two roads, the Columbus Avenue and 72nd Street. So we saw that how there was no window and no light also in the other room, 501. According to Dr. Mishra, Prabhupada moved in order to have his own place independent of the Mishra Yoga Society. So now he was all on his own. So he, in between, he tried to write to the Universal Book House of Bombay and many other book publication centers in India to try to push his Bhagavatams. And he's saying that, you know, please, I have a big industrialist of India has promised to pay for the cost. So please see that how you can take charge of distribution throughout India. But comes a reply of total, let's see what the reply is. So what Mr. Dharmatkar, he is replying, I cannot give you a very happy news on the progress of the sale of Srimad Bhagavatam. Because the subject is religious and only a small section of society may personally be interested in the books. We tried to push them through some booksellers to Nagpur, Ahmedabad, Pune, etc. But regret to inform you that after some time, these booksellers returned the books for want of response. As such, we are not only unenthusiastic to agree to your proposal of taking up sales for all India, but we were just thinking of requesting you to nominate some other people in our place to represent your sale program in Maharashtra. So even they are declining from being a promoter or distributor in Maharashtra also because these books are returned. So that was the condition of India at that time. So what he says, so far they had only sold only six sets of his books for which they were about to transfer ₹172 to his account. This was hardly encouraging to the author. Again, India was not interested. Even in the land of religion, religious subjects were only for a small section of the society. So this was one reverse. And then Srila Prabhupada wrote to the next Prime Minister, Indira Gandhi. And what was her response? The Prime Minister, from the official secretary, the response came. The Prime Minister had seen your letter of February 8, 1966. She appreciates the spirit which prompted you to carry the spiritual message of Srimad Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam to other countries. Owing to the critical foreign exchange situation which the country is facing, it is greatly regretted that it will not be possible to assist you from here in your plan to set up a Radha Krishna temple. So any possibility of government sanction is closed. And Padampad Singhania also almost wrote that that's the last thing that I can write. I don't agree with your proposal. So he again wrote to Tirtha Maharaj, but he waited for 1 month and there was no answer. And again he wrote to many of his godbrothers and saying that every day, so he's saying, he had written that he had needed encouragement from them to continue in America because it was so expensive. He had explained that he was spending the equivalent of 1,000 rupees a month just for his own, you know, rent and food and groceries. As such, I'm counting every day to receive your favorable replies. but there was no reply. Even though Padampat Singhania almost shut the door, Prabhupada saw a ray of light coming from in between the shut door, maybe possibly, and he again, you know, sent him a letter, and he wrote to Sumati Morarji also, and there was no reply from her. So this time, as his financial situation became more urgent and his hopes more strained, his support from India withdrew in silence. His unanswered correspondence was itself a kind of message, loud and clear: "We cannot help you." But although no one encouraged him, Srila Prabhupada trusted in the order of the spiritual master and the will of Krishna. The word from the Prime Minister regarding government action had been a definite no, but he had received another extension of his visa. Now his last hope was Sir Padampat Singhania. Prabhupada knew that he was so influential a man in India that if he wanted, he could send the money. He was Prabhupada's final hope. But to this reply, Padampat Singhania didn't even reply personally. He asked his secretary, Mr. Ishwara Iyer, to send the reply. What was that? "I regret to write that Sir Padampat ji is not interested in the scheme of building a Radha Krishna temple in New York at present. In regard to the inquiry contained in the last paragraph of your letter, Sir Padampat ji duly received your books of Srimad Bhagavatam from your Delhi office, yours faithfully." Just a two-line letter telling that he is not interested. So all the doors are closed for Srila Prabhupada right now. But he wouldn't give up. So this is what he writes in Nectar of Instruction. "In the beginning, there was no response, but I continued the devotional service with patience, and then gradually people came." But what he continued to do was reading of Chaitanya Charitamrita, which was the nectarine of his life. And he did not stop his work on Srimad Bhagavatam or offering food to Krishna, distributing prasadam, or Krishna's philosophy of Bhagavad Gita, explaining that to whomever would come at that point of time. But he had faith in Krishna's words, "Name Bhakta Pranashyati," "My devotee will never be vanquished." So there was never any doubt about this for Prabhupada. The only question was whether Americans would take notice of the pure devotee in their midst. At this point, it seemed that no one was going to take him seriously. So, Srila Prabhupada ki jai, in writing his purport, in explaining the same thing in the 13th chapter, 8 to 12 verses of Bhagavad Gita, Srila Prabhupada writes about determination, that there will be so many obstacles, when, especially when one is trying to practice and preach, but one should continue with determination. And who else could be more determined than Srila Prabhupada? Not even swerving an inch from his goal of pleasing his spiritual master, establishing something to spread Krishna consciousness from basically nothing. Very grateful to him. So next time when we go into a ISKCON temple and then we see the darshan of Radha Krishna, we can remember this chapter and be grateful to Srila Prabhupada for taking on all this and giving us now the treasure of worshipping Radha Krishna in all over the world. So thank you so much, dear devotees, for letting me share some things that's inspiring me. I know all of you almost already know this, but it's for my own purification. I wanted to share this. And thanks for the opportunity, Srimati Mataji. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Srimati ki jai, Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji, for really, really great, wonderful class. And also, it's just like one day after Prabhupada's disappearance day today, hearing about glory of Prabhupada and how much he has struggled, really. Like for us, sometimes I feel personally that small challenges in spiritual life, we feel, oh, so many challenges, but how he has really faced with his determination, wonderful reminders for all of us. So thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna, dear devotees, if you have any questions, comments, or relations, please do unmute yourself.
Hare Krishna, Lalitani Mataji, please accept my humble obeisances. All rest to Srila Prabhupada and Guru Maharaj. Thank you so much, Mataji. Thank you so much for reminding us once again how determined Srila Prabhupada was in his endeavors and how focused he was towards his goal. Yeah, that was really amazing. And we should be always very grateful for Srila Prabhupada, what he did for us. Yes, Mataji. Thank you so much. It was very nice.
Dear Lalitani Mataji, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Prabhupada, all glories to Gurudev. Sorry, I'm just rushing in because I have to leave in a few minutes. But I wanted to take this opportunity to thank you for such a wonderful reminder of Srila Prabhupada's determination in the face of impossible odds and such very challenging circumstances, just for us to feel more grateful for what we have received as a result of Srila Prabhupada's efforts to save us. So thank you so very much. I'm very grateful to you for this.
Thank you, Mataji. I am learning a lot from your daily questions, your reflections, and your classes. So I am very grateful to you for that. And please accept my humble obeisances.
So Hare Krishna, dear devotees, please unmute yourself if you have any questions.
The next chapter is even more heart-wrenching. At least now, his life, his hopes are gone, but his life would itself be threatened. The next chapter, so read that also. Be grateful and grateful to Srila Prabhupada because this gratitude will keep us together, and we can cross over the obstacles in our path by remembering such. Qualities of
determination. Yes, Mataji. Yeah.
It reminds me, Mataji, one thing. I was just hearing about this same chapter in one of the class, and where one Prabhu mentioned that he heard this from one of the Prabhupada disciples, that when he saw this property and initially he was not having any money, nothing. But he was so confident, he told this owner that I have got the arrangement, everything done. And even after all the failures, he was very confident. Yeah, I have got everything. Don't worry. You just think about how to think about the next step. So such firm faith in Krishna along with determination, absolutely... Like such unflinching faith, absolutely great.
Yes, Prabhuji. Thank you, Prabhuji, for that wonderful reflection. He's not moved by material circumstances at all. You can see that, his faith is everything is transcendental.
How we will get that much faith, Mataji? It's very impossible for me, but I'll always wonder, hearing about Srila Prabhupada, I always think how he got that much faith, because we see that in his whole life, almost until he left his home, he was like a grihastha only always, and he was into all this business and everything. And how he could develop that much faith, because just only the point that he has to follow his spiritual master's order or instruction, only that point gave him that much faith, or what else would be there, Mataji?
Yeah, that's what I've heard of Mataji. When he first saw Bhaktis Temple Saraswati Thakur, when he was offering obeisances, and before he was lifting the head, he got the instruction, "You are an educated young man, why don't you preach this in the West?" And he had firm faith and belief that this can be done. And I heard one pastime that when he was in Calcutta in Sitakant Banerjee Lane, where his family was downstairs, and he had a room for preaching upstairs, where people from Gaudiya Math, the devotees and sannyasis from Gaudiya Math, would come and preach there often. And he would go on with his business, and then he would come in the night and he would chant his rounds, hearing those classes. He was facilitating in some way or other. And there was a grammar class that was taken by one devotee. I forgot the devotee's name. And he, after the class is over, is coming down the steps and he's asking, at that time, Abhay Babu, "Abhay Babu, do you think this is really Prithvite, Nache, Nagaradigram, Sarvatra Prachare Hode Morena? Is this a Prithvi here? Does this apply only to India or to the whole world? Because we don't see every town and village." And then he says that, you know, it must have been mentioned only India. But Srila Prabhupada says, no. If it is said that Prithvi, it is whole world. But who will do it? That was his question. And for that, Prabhupada got up from the steps, he was chanting, and he looked at him and he answered, any fool who surrendered to Srila Bhaktis, our Srila Prabhupada, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, will be able to do it. And he says, not you. I mean, Prabhupada, you know, right? That was a conversation. And this Prabhu, this sannyasi Maharaj was wondering, not me? Then is it that Abhay Babu who will do it? He is going everywhere for business. He would go to Chennai. He would go to east, south, everything. He's completely immersed in his business. And he saw, is he going to do it? That was his thought. Then in 1972, he was in Bhubaneswar. At that time, he's seen this American Vaishnava stun, very tall and you know, well built, and with tilak and shika, and that was like in saffron robes, so stunned. And he's asking him, "Who are you?" and all, and he's giving him a back to back magazine, and he has asked him, "Who's your guru?" So he opens the page and shows that this is my guru. He says, "Abhay Babu, when did he take sannyas?" That was his response. Then immediately that Prabhu was Bhagavad Das at that time, Bhagavad Prabhu. So he immediately, "Abhay Babu, how do you know?" Then he came to know that he is his god brother, and immediately he paid obeisances. And it was he who told this Bhagavad Prabhu that what happened at this pastime, that when he was teaching that. So, yeah, again and again, he's saying the same thing, no? Yasya deve thara bhaktir yatha deve tata guru tasya ite katidayante prakashante mahatmanah. One who has unflinching deep faith on guru and Krishna, to him, everything will be revealed. So how do we get that faith? By association with those people who are in that process of getting the faith, and also by seeing these examples, how he achieved this, right? With simply faith. And as Prabhu said, that, you know, there was no encouragement, absolutely nothing at all for him, except that his faith that he had to do this for his Guru Maharaj. And he was successful. So that's something that that we see that it happened. And also I heard that Shraddha to Prema is a slow increase of faith. And that faith only matures into bhava, prema, bhava and prema. So basically, it is all different different degrees of faith. And the nine point, that nine chapter, Prabhupada explains that Kanishtha Adhikari, Madhyam Adhikari, Uttam Adhikari, Kanishtha Adhikari, one with a pliable and a soft faith, and then one when the faith becomes firmed up, and he cannot be diverted with the knowledge from scriptures and with his practice, then the faith is Madhyam Adhikari, then it becomes Uttam Adhikari. So it is not a one day or a process or a short term process. I feel this is a long term process, and we need to keep going in, taking the association of people who have developed the faith, and you know, holding their hand. It's like holding their hand or holding their feet. We move above. That's what I have heard, Mother.
Thank you, Mataji. Thank you so much. I remember our old days where you we were discussing in Bhakta Rikshas and all. I miss your association a lot. Now I realize. Thank you so much.
I'm in fact very much you know, inspired by the association of you and your whole family of devotees. So it's mutual. Thank you for that.
Thank you, Mataji.
I think we don't have any further questions, Mataji.
Yeah, last 1 hour, so I think we can end.
So thank you very much, Mataji. Thank you for your time and wonderful session, wonderful nectar. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Guru Maharaj ki jai, Anant Koti Vaishnav Brind ki jai.
We look forward for more sessions, Mataji. And thank you so much for your association.
Thank you, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, thank you.